Thank you very much for this opportunity. I would like to talk to you about freshwater fishes of Kenya. My name, as you've heard, is Wanja Nyingi. I'm a curator of fish at the National Museums of Kenya, and my work involves primarily research on fishes in Kenya. As you can see in that map, those are the drainages of Kenya, the freshwater drainages of Kenya. This is a map that shows the extent of all the small and large rivers and the lakes that they drain into. And you can see that we have a lot of cross or transboundary interactions of these systems. And therefore, when we study freshwater fishes of Kenya, we are also studying freshwater fishes in other regions, such as Ethiopia, if we look at the Turkana system, Uganda, if we're talking about the rivers that drain into Lake Victoria, and of course, the Pangani system and Wasungiro system that is shared between Kenya and Tanzania. In brief, we have five main hydrological systems. We have the Lake Turkana system, we have the Lake Victoria system, we have the Rift Valley lakes, and then we have the rivers that flow eastwards, two of which flow into the Indian Ocean and one that flows into the Laurian Swamp and is connected to systems in Somalia. And then of course we have the Pangani, which we share with Tanzania. In Kenya, we have approximately 32 families that we know of fishes, approximately 300 known species of fish. The reason I say known is because in all our research, those are the ones that we have so far been able to ascertain exist within our region. You can see the graph there, there's not much detail you can read, but the spike in it is the cichlids, and the cichlids are the tilapia fishes, tilapia-like fishes, followed by the cyprinids, which are also a large number, over 50 species. The cichlids we know over 100, but the reason we say known is because the Lake Victoria particularly has many cichlids that are yet not discovered. And even as we speak daily about our lack of knowledge of this fish, they are continuously threatened by extinction. So I'd like to just feature on a few lakes that have some important migratory species and fish species that we have in the past been monitoring in terms of how these species move around in the lake, to the rivers, and within the lake, and whether they are barred by any development within the lakes or the rivers in migration. So Lake Turkana is at the north. We share this with Ethiopia. It's the largest desert lake in the world, and it is typically a Nilo-Sudanic ecosystem, meaning that it is related to the Nile. Most of the fish that you'll find in Lake Turkana also exist in the Nile and have evolved through the Nile system. The lake itself, some may not know, has three islands, the North, Central, and South Island, and is fed predominantly by the Omo River from Ethiopia. And this is why it is very important for both countries to have a very good understanding on the future of the Lake Turkana, which is based on the Omo. The Takwel and Kerio are not great inputs. Another thing to note is that the lake itself has no outflow river, and all the water that flows out or that leaves is through evaporation. So that's the shape of the lake itself. You can see the part that's in Ethiopia and the part that is in Kenya. I wanted to show you just what we mean in terms of species there. We have about 19 families out of the 32 we know in Kenya, and a total of 56 species, most of which, 45, are of the lake, whereas the others occur only on the river. Now, I wanted to talk especially about one particular fish, but I wanted to just show you the types of fishes that exist there. This is a lungfish. This is a labelle fish, which is a cyprinid. We have mud fishes. We have cichlids, such as these two. So that's just a snapshot of what you would see. But here we have what we call the hydrocyanus, the tiger fishes. We have two species that exist in Kenya, all found in the Turkana system. The hydrocyanus, the tiger fishes, they live in the open water. They're fast swimming, and they also shoal, meaning they occur in groups. But the interesting thing about them is that they often are very, very territorial, and yet at the same time have migratory habits. So we have two breeding populations that we know, one in the Lake Turkana and another one in the Omo River. This fish moves. It has been recorded in a lot of places, but research is yet to show for the Tana that they can move within a range of 1,000 meters, but even farther. And these movements are mostly for breeding. They prefer to live in areas that have a lot more wetland and other properties such as plant, because of what they feed on. They feed on small fish, they feed on macroinvertebrates, they also feed on snails and crustaceans. So they would occur in places where that is plenty. But they rely a lot on migration, and therefore it's very important that the Omo River itself does not become blocked to inhibit movement of this fish. In the map I showed you, the eastward flowing rivers, there are very many rivers along the coast, some are smaller streams that flow into the Indian Ocean. And here we have a special interaction between fish that move from freshwater to marine water and from marine water to freshwater for purposes of breeding and feeding and just important stages in their life cycle. And here I wanted to talk about the Tana River Delta. This is the largest river in Kenya. Even though we say it is large, in Africa, it's probably the 10th in terms of flow, quantity of flow. But it is an important river that rises from the Aberdare Ranges and Mount Kenya and drains into the Indian Ocean. We've recorded several species from this drainage, most of which are cichlids, the purple part you see here, and again, cyprinids. And that shows just the diversity of this species. Here we have some cyprinids, such as the labeo, which is very common. We have these catfishes, which attach themselves to rocks. We have elephant snout fishes, and the neobola fish, which you see here, is a kind of sardine, which is very unique to this system and actually endemic. And also we have the mountain catfishes, which occur in the upper streams. Of interest today, and you have also heard from a previous speaker, is a catrodomous migration of the freshwater eels. In this case, this has been a great concern in terms of whether the rivers are adequately flowing and maintained to a level that these fishes are continuing their life cycle movement from the freshwater to the marine to breed and back. Now, one might think that because there are no large dams towards the delta areas, that these fish are secure, but not so much. Just on the 24th September this year, we had a newspaper report actually of thousands of fish killed due to what we referred to as an environmental disaster. This followed after the Tana River community at the Chara village blocked a major brook, the Matomba Brook, which is one of the major brooks of the delta itself into the ocean. The reason they blocked it is because they wanted to safeguard fresh water. There's been a lot of seawater intrusion into fresh water in the coastal areas of Kenya, mainly due to the lack of large, mainly due to reduced quantities of water flowing from upstream. These flows have been reduced due to agriculture, they've been reduced due to damming, and also because of climate change and less rain over the years. Apart from the last 3 years, the Tana River Delta has seen some significant drying. So therefore communities had become desperate. Their land was becoming salty because of saltwater intrusion. They were lacking in fresh water as well because of the same reasons. So they thought one thing we can do is to block the sea from the river. Now, that action alone caused stranding of several fishes in this delta. So therefore, it's very important for us, even as fish scientists, to be able to look at the larger picture in every research that we do. It's not just the fish, but the ecosystem itself. How do you help communities manage an ecosystem when they are also fighting impacts of climate change and also trying to make their livelihoods? So the question is, this community needs water. The water comes from upstream. If not enough is coming, then salt water will intrude. Their solution was to maintain the water fresh by blocking the sea. This solution unfortunately caused a lot of stranding of fish and a lot of fish deaths, both of freshwater and marine fish that were found in that segment of the Matomba Brook. So we need to work very closely with the managers of the ecosystem, with other people who work on water quality and how to manage dams in order to look at the big picture in terms of fish migrations.
We need to start wrapping up.
Yes, I'd like to draw attention to this book, A Guide to Common Freshwater Fishes of Kenya, which will be useful for finding more information about fishes. And if you have any questions, please do not hesitate to write to me by email at wanjanyingi@gmail.com in order for us to interact more about fishes of Kenya. With any questions you might have about fish, I'm sure to help find the answers.
Thank you so very much. That was super interesting. Okay, bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye.
Did you mean lamp eyes or lamp praise? Which type of puffa in Al-Kutana? Turkana, sorry.
Are you speaking about this slide? Yes, in this case, we were not talking about lampreys, we're talking about lampeyes, which are a specific type of freshwater fish, whereby lampreys would be marine.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Then the next question was, have you looked at river diversions along the Galana Kulalu project, and how has this affected migratory eels?
Well, no, that was not something that we have looked at, but I believe that the speaker who will be talking to you about eels will be more able to do that. For me, we have been looking at eels mostly in the Tana and the Ramisi rivers and trying to figure out whether their migrations can be traced. However, since our work as researchers at the museum is mostly about biodiversity, we have not had any specific projects on how migrations occur. What we can do is provide reports of where we have sighted fish and where we've collected them in order to help scientists and ecologists to understand where they have occurred in the past and the present.
And then the last question you have is, how far do the tigerfish migrate?
In the Lake Turkana itself, we do not know because the research is yet to be concluded by the ecologists. However, studies have shown in, for example, like the Zambezi River and other places, some scientists have been able to trace their migrations to short distances of about a kilometer or so in areas where they occur, but even higher, up to 14 kilometers for purposes of reproduction and other life cycle purposes that are yet to be described for the Lake Turkana.
There's one more question. I just want to click on it. It asked me if I want to answer this question live, and I said yes. And it says, is this book available as PDF?
Yes, I have noticed that people have asked for this a lot, but the PDF version, according to that has been provided by the publisher, unfortunately is not in color. So the photos would not be great. We've been working with the publisher to do that, but we have it best in print version.
Okay, another question. And again, if you could answer that. Could you share any other info you may have on eels in Kenya?
I would like to leave this to our speaker who will discuss about eels, since what I do know is their diversity, but not their ecology. So I would like to divert this question to our speaker on eels.
I'm not sure if there's any more questions, but that's it that we've gotten from this group of attendees.
Okay, thank you so much, Wanja.
Thank you.
I'm going to stop the recording.